In a world where humanity has been brought to its knees by a deadly virus, the remaining survivors live under the oppressive rule of a new breed of beings, the Zomgans. These half-human, half-zombie hybrids have risen to power after the viral outbreak, leaving the once-thriving human civilization in ruins. Amidst the chaos and terror, a small group of survivors must band together to fight for their lives and resist the iron grip of their undead oppressors. In this gripping tale of survival, hope, and courage, the fate of humanity rests in the hands of those who refuse to give up in the face of impossible odds. He stands at the front of the building, flipping and tossing as he checks his jotter. His movements catch the attention of the guards, who initially doubt if he is human. However, upon realizing he is, they ask him what he is looking for. They assume he is there to rescue a friend who has been captured. Nudged by his boldness, they consider him as potential food for a feast. As they ascend to the top floor to enjoy their meal, the thought of feasting on human flesh after so long excites them. They are pleased to find that he has come to them voluntarily. However, their happiness is short-lived as he suddenly appears again. They wonder how he managed to enter without the guards' notice, but he drops the heads of the two guards he had encountered earlier. He shows no fear as he asks if there is anyone named Craven. To their surprise, they inform him that there is no one by that name. They ask if he is there to rescue a friend, but he denies ever meeting him. This angers them, and they demand to know why he killed their guards. He simply tells them that the guards annoyed him. The leader, outraged, calls on Jeff to deal with him using the day's menu of hotel style. Jeff swings his sword, but it is not enough to kill him. In the end, he kills Jeff instead. As a surprise for them, the group leader ordered all the boys to capture him, thinking he must have used some trick that wouldn't work against them a second time. They were angry about how he dared to enter Zomgan territory and take out the elite guards, and the leader instructed them all to avenge Jeff. They growled and made noises as if they were not human. He picked up human bones from the ground and started hitting them with them. To their surprise, he managed to knock down half of them. The rest began to tremble. Then he belched something in his hand, spun it, and threw it up with the bone, sending it flying towards them and cutting off the heads of the Zogmans, except their master, who was shocked he could have done such a thing despite his small size. Suddenly, he appeared in front of the Zogman's leader, making him wonder how he had just gotten there so quickly. He asked if he was Craven, the leader, but instead asked why he was looking for Craven. It was because someone told him Craven might kill him, which made the leader proud as he took out his sword to strike him down. The guy squeezed him with a kind of power he had gathered in his hand, making the leader burst into pieces. He defeated them all in the blink of an eye, making the rest of the guys tremble, wondering if he would kill them too, but he spared them. He asked the boy if he knew where he could find Craven, and the boy told him that Craven was the last Zomgan he killed. The boy thanked him for saving him. He has failed once again. As he leaves the building, he takes out his notebook and crosses out a Zomgan. Many years ago, the world was destroyed by a zombie virus, and humans were scarce. Most survivors were zombies, and these zombies evolved into monsters known as Zomgans, which were half-human, half-zombie hybrids. The emergence of the zombies led to the destruction of civilization as it was known. He managed to survive as a human, but ever since that day, he has been unable to die. As the captain arrived, they questioned Guho, the boy captured by the Zomgan, about why he didn't radio them and were surprised at what had happened. Guho told them that he didn't know Craven was not there and was investigating the area but unfortunately got caught. They looked puzzled at what had happened while Guho informed them that a kid suddenly showed up, which perplexed the captain. The kid had killed all the Zomgans on his own. It's hard to believe, but that's the truth. Although Guho doesn't know why he showed up, he took them all out instantly. The captain asked where the kid was, and Gyuho informed them that he couldn't tell because as he was about to ask him some questions, he left in a hurry. The thing was that he looked so scary that Gyuho had lost his nerve. As Gyuho explained to the captain, he began sweating and thus asked if the kid was also a Zongan, but Gyuho was pretty sure he was human. The captain scanned the building and saw that he was wearing trainers. As they moved out in search of him, they saw him from afar while they hid behind a tree to cover themselves. He looked like a little kid, making them question Gyuho if he was indeed the one who killed the Zongans. The captain noticed that Gyuho had been sitting there for a while and wondered what he was doing. Thinking it was him, the captain moved closer to the kid and slashed him. It was quite amazing. The captain seemed to have tried to kill the kid, and it looked like he was faster than the kid, as his head flew into the air. The captain shot the flying head to be sure the kid was dead. To his utmost surprise, the kid pooped out a new head from his neck, and this made the captain realize he couldn't kill him. The kid told the captain to stop bothering him and go away. Hearing the kid say that made the captain want to annoy him even more, so he kicked the kid off. As he dashed to the back, he fired a heavy gunshot, but the kid dodged it with an ability that puzzled the captain. The kid seemed to try to kill the captain with his power, but reconsidered as he wasn't sure what the captain was doing. He instructed the captain to leave him alone, as he didn't like killing humans. He then slid back the power he had pushed out of his body. The captain was still not satisfied. He dashed at the kid again with a knife and, as he halted, asked the kid how long it generally takes for him to regenerate, as the wound on his neck hadn't healed yet. The kid looked surprised as the wound had never taken so long to regenerate. He asked the captain how she did it, and she introduced herself as Gyeong Lee, a captain under the Eradication Front. She requested that he join the Eradication Front, as he had a valuable talent, being an immortal kid. Of course, she wasn't just asking him to join their group and offering anything in return. She had something in it for him too. Gyuho told her he wished to die and asked her to grant him that wish. The child wondered what Lee was talking about. Lee told him that they had a capable scientist who should be able to figure out a way to kill him. She explained that the scientist made the knife she was holding and since it was the first time something like this had happened to him, they would make his wish come true. Lee asked for his name, and he replied that his name was Mirei On. Lee promised Mirei that she would help him eliminate all the Zongans so they could reclaim their land. She also promised to ensure his death once human society had been rebuilt. Lee looked forward to working with Mirei until that day. Her hope, which had begun to fade, was now being rekindled. If they kept their promise, he might be able to die. Garam appeared to be on her way with a car, but it was taking longer than they had anticipated. However, just as they thought she might still be far away, she arrived. Lee instructed Mirei to get into the car quickly so they could get going. Garam wondered who Mirei was, and Lee explained that he was a new recruit who had recently joined them, and that she would be in charge of him. Garam was pleased at the prospect of a promotion and introduced herself formally to Mirei as Garam Jin. She suggested that he sit in the front as he seemed shy. As they boarded the bus, Lee informed Mirei that their mission was to explore the Jinha district, which was currently under the control of the Crimson Gang. The Crimson Gang was a group of Zongans who had taken over several cities, and their primary goal was to take them down. To do that, they needed to find out where their boss was, and that's why they were investigating Craven, who was a member of the Crimson Gang. One of the leaders of the Crimson Gang, Paladin, was believed to be in the Jinhe district, and it was possible that the Paladin had some contact with the boss. Therefore, Mirei and Garam had to be careful as they conducted their investigation, which could lead them to the boss. Craven may have been the leader of a group, but a paladin governs an entire city. It would be best for them to travel together, but there were other places they needed to investigate. In the Jinhae district, Changwon City, Garam and Marie were dropped off at the outskirts of the city. It was safer for them to go on foot from there, as the area was quite dangerous. Garam would inform Mirei of some specifics, and they would proceed from there. This was Garam's first mission, and she felt nervous but had to set a good example for Mirei, her senior. Fortunately, they managed to enter the city safely, but that was where things got serious. Garam realized she needed to stay alert because everyone in the district was a Zongan. Moreover, the whole district was collaborating with chimeric Zongans, and they might jump out unexpectedly. Meanwhile, the other team members, including Lee and the rest, kept an eye on them through a camera. Some of them doubted if Garam and Marie would be safe alone, but Lee reassured them that Mirei's presence made a difference since he was confident in his abilities. Still, Lee was curious about Mirei's motives for joining them and wondered if he had ulterior motives.
Lee wanted to observe him for a little longer before she could trust him. As Garam and Marie continued their search, Garam seemed to be afraid, and suddenly Zongans appeared, just as she had mentioned them. The Zongans were discussing the death of Craven when Marie fearlessly walked up to them, amazing the Zongan. They wondered why there was a human in their jurisdiction. Perhaps he had lost his mind. Even if they hadn't told him before going on the mission, it was apparent that they had to sneak around. Morse thought it would be fine if he killed them. He then transcended, and his body bulged, causing a loud rumble that made the object in his hand grow bigger. He then threw it at the Zongans. The team did not expect the captain to recruit an average person. But he is actually on a completely different level. Morse steps closer to the Zongans, who are wondering what is wrong with him, perhaps doubting if he is human. He unleashes his power from his hand and slashes the Zongan. He turns, rumbles, then unleashes another power from his hand and throws it at the Zongans again. The other team members who were watching from afar with a camera were amazed by the incredible skill and power Marie had, while Garam was still hiding behind cars, watching everything that was going on. They did not think he was as powerful as he actually is. The other Zongans began to come out from different angles in large numbers, wondering what was going on. As they were coming out, Marie was slashing them down with his powers. Meanwhile, Garam became angry at all the happenings, knowing it would be hard for her to fight multiple enemies at once. She took out a book and manifested the ability of knowledge to transfer boxing, and began to take down the Zongans too. As they continued to get rid of the Zongans, Marie was interrupted by Garam, who asked him if he wanted to destroy the city. Marie moved closer to a low-ranked Zongan who was trembling in fear as he approached. Then he noticed something. The Zongan possibly had his mother's spirit, and he let the Zongan go, surprising Garam. Just as he let the Zongan free, other Zongans began coming out again, which perplexed Garam as to how many they had to fight again. However, they managed to finish all of them. It was then that Marie asked about the Paladin, who seemed to have died while editing the chaos. But why hasn't the Paladin shown up yet? Their actions should have been enough to get their attention. Were they killed during the commotion? Garam doesn't seem to care anymore and tells Marie they need to hide for the moment. However, Marie asks what they would do if more Zongans came, as they would have to kill them. He is sure that one of them has to be a Paladin. Still, Garam reminds him that they are there to investigate the Zongans and not to fight them. Marie is not concerned by her pleas as he believes they can examine them after they kill them. He doesn't care if they have to fight all day long, whether Garam lives or dies. He just has to carry out the mission. Garam is perplexed by him. He couldn't even care if she lived, not reminding him that they were there to save people. No matter how vital the mission may be, people's lives will always be more critical. Unfortunately, Marie doesn't see it that way. Just then, a Zongan appears. His body is covered in blades, and he has an iron mask on his back. Without a doubt, he might be the Paladin himself. Garam slumps down in fear, already stressed and out of strength. When will that Paladin appear? But even if she could fight, could she defeat those Zongans who came along with the Paladin? She went over the events of the past 350 seconds after hearing that Kevin, her younger brother, was this guy. What the hell was that? That's the guy who killed Craven. Oh, the guy who seems to be Paladin is surprised as to how he could kill Craven, including everyone in this group. Still, he has heard about humans having special abilities called Transcended and didn't realize those rumors might be true. He has it in mind that no matter what Marie might be planning, he would not let him survive after hurting his family. The other team members, including the captain, who were watching from afar, didn't expect Marie's sudden attack and thought it was best to help. As they moved in, Garam held Marie back, reminding him that the man was the leader of the Crimson Gang and they needed to run, not fight. No matter how strong Marie was, he could die. But Marie was undeterred and saw it as an opportunity. The Paladin was angry and threatened to kill Marie. Murray then dashed towards the other Zongans and began to kill them, frustrating the paladin even more. The paladin thought of Murray as prey and planned to attack him without him noticing. But as he lunged towards Murray, his blade went through him and Murray didn't die. The paladin felt fear for the first time, and Garam was amazed. The paladin tried to spin around Murray, believing he could not keep up with his speed. But he was wrong. Murray was on another level and defeated the paladin. The paladin realized he could not win and fled. But Murray chased after him. With a swing of his hand, Murray lifted the paladin, who was devastated as he realized he too used to have a family. His mother had asked him if the food tasted good while they were together. Unfortunately, she also turned into a zombie, and he had to kill her with his own hands. She was his only family. As he was killing the zombie, a paladin appeared and threatened him, warning that other paladins wouldn't take it easy on him. However, Murray was fighting for his family, too. He defeated the paladin and sent him to the ground. The other team members were amazed by Murray's powers. Lee, the captain, called off the mission. She had ordered them to investigate the Jinhi district, but Murray had destroyed the area, making it impossible to continue the investigation. She then ordered everyone to follow her back to their base. Lee felt uneasy, not because she thought Murray had any ulterior motives, but because the Zongans might be enemies they had to kill, but there was no need to be cruel. Lee thought that if Murray was human, he should have a shred of humanity, but she couldn't see that in him. She had never thought she would feel sorry for a Zongan, but she didn't know what to make of it. Was she recruiting someone more of a monster than a Zongan? Lee ordered everyone to return to the base as they might encounter more Zongans. She warned them to be careful. She could only sense Zongan blood, and there are no signs of any human blood, which was really more annoying for them. Even humans were causing trouble for them now, but they seemed to sense it was not King since they left. One of them suggested that they notify other executives but didn't accept the idea, thinking they had to find and kill them. That way, they would not have to deal with any nagging. As the concept looked marvelous to the other one, they decided to take care of it quickly before they got any grief over it. The fire was burning as they sat around it at their camp, taking a short break before setting off again, as the sun had already gone down. They thought there was no point in pushing themselves too hard. Lee, the captain, saw that they all seemed a bit down. Well, it was not that the mission was a total failure. An entire Zongan city was destroyed, but they didn't know how many Zongans would retaliate either. And most importantly, their most significant asset had become their biggest problem. She was testing Murray, but there was something she wanted to double check. She tried to see whether she could trust him or not. She had told him to investigate Jinhi, but all he did was desultory look into it. And as a result of that, Garam was dragged into their fight against her will and could have been seriously injured. But they were lucky to have won. And if Murray had lost to the paladin, then every one of them could have been killed. And that was the main reason she thought of testing Murray. Murray complained that she had told him to wipe out the Zongans, and he had just followed her orders. However, she had meant that they needed to eliminate the Zongans and rebuild human society. She knew that charging in and taking on the Zongans without a second thought, like Murray wanted, would result in the death of all humans. Even if they managed to build a new city, it would not be a true human society. She had brought Murray along because she needed him, and he had come with them because he needed to. However, his reckless behavior could put all of them in danger. Although he wanted to die, he had to obey her orders. They accepted what was said, but they still had another problem to deal with. They had devastated Zongan City and killed one of their paladins, which could be seen as a declaration of war. There was no doubt that the other executives would mobilize against them. Suddenly, the two Zongans who had decided to find and kill those who had destroyed their city before reporting to others saw the light from the cave. One of them called out to the second one, supposedly Yurairu, saying that they were right there as the human scent stopped there. They seemed to have caught up with them now and dashed inside the cave with fumes of anger. Unfortunately, they couldn't find anyone inside, which left them disappointed. They wondered if they had lost their scent, or if the smell of food had made it difficult to track them. They thought there might be a clever human among them, leaving them with no other choice. They wanted to take care of it themselves, but they had to call a meeting with other executives. Humans had started a rebellion, and they needed to treat the situation carefully. As Lee and Murray drove to Busan, Lee asked if Murray had been there before. It used to be a nice area, but the Zongans had taken over. Humans who lived there had two choices: become enslaved to the Zongans or be devoured by them. Neither option was how humans should live. They were stopped by some road officers who asked if they had seen the sticker for human enslaved people on their car. They were probably transporting vegetables or something. The officers were angry because they didn't want to be distracted from catching the human who caused a stir in Jinhi. They stopped the car and continued on foot through an unpleasant tunnel, the only way to reach their headquarters. They finally arrived at the eradication fronts of the headquarters. Lee thought there were things she had to show Murray, but for the moment, they had to focus on the task at hand. Suddenly, Nurichin's commander appeared, demanding to know what they were doing at Jome. the Zongan security guards had become more aggressive, and when they informed the commander that they were investigating, she demanded to know what they had accomplished. Li asked if she could update her on the situation later, but the commander insisted on hearing the details immediately. Li explained that she was busy at the moment and introduced Marie to the commander. She informed the commander that they were planning to confront all the executives at some point, but they did not know how many executives there were or how powerful they might be. The only executives they were aware of were the paladins, who were the weakest of all the executives. Li instructed Marie to attack her without holding back to test his strength. Marie asked if this was an order, and the commander confirmed that it was. The other team members were curious if there was something their captain wanted to check. The commander realized that they might have fought before and that Li might not have used her ability during their previous encounter. She wanted to find out if Marie could beat her when she was using her ability. Marie was strong, and they would likely rely on him for future missions. They needed to have confidence in his abilities. They needed to be confident that Marie could defeat the executives, and now he was here. Captain Li was the most vital member of the team. After the Zongans appeared, they discovered that some humans possessed a rare potential to become transcenders. Their powers allowed them to fight on an even footing with Zongans and, in some cases, even surpass them. Besides Garam and Li, there were other transcenders on the team, but the captain was the strongest. She was trained in several different martial arts, and her physical abilities exceeded those of other humans. Most importantly, she could manifest the power of the All-Seeing Eyes, an unrivaled ability that allowed users to calculate all the possibilities within their field of vision. If Murray could beat the captain, he would be the most potent human and would have truly defeated the strongest team member. He threw bone projectiles and used his knowledge of anatomy to target arteries and veins. He had many different attacks at his disposal, but with the all-seeing eyes, Captain Li could see that 9 bones were coming at her in total and she crumbled them to dust. He attacked her again, this time with a more robust power that was different from his first attack. In theory, she could see and dodge bullets with the all-seeing eyes. But Miri's attack was even faster than bullets, which made him more capable than she had anticipated. She ordered him to stop, as he had already won. And that was more than enough since she couldn't counter-attack. Although their battle was short, it gave the onlookers new hope. They caught a glimpse of the possibility of a new world and were filled with confidence. With this, they began the preparation to defeat the executive. Murray wondered why he couldn't even hit her once, while Captain Li went to meet Commander Nuri, who had something in mind. Before Murray could say anything, the commander had already guessed that Murray was the reason why security guards were so tight. She saw that they had recruited a strong guy without really thinking it through, and he had probably destroyed a city along the way. He looked intelligent to Nuri's face, but Li found him quite annoying as the situation had become more complicated. They then decided to go to Oriuk Island, the human slave farm. They knew they might need some potent weapons, as they would be facing a total war. They needed to leave right away and bring back Jian, the scientist who went there to investigate and had promised to kill Murray after he had completed his mission with them. The knife with Li had an effect on him, and since Jian was the one who had made it, he could make it possible to kill Murray's immortality. To go to Oriuk, they planned to gather more people and secure more weapons. Since they were going to deal with a large number of Zongans, they had to travel by ship, and that meant dealing with a large number of Zongans at the port. When they reached the Busan port, they split up and had to look for boats while staying hidden, as there were a lot of Zongans everywhere at the port. They had to take them down one by one quietly. In Busan City, the meeting of the Crimson Gang leaders, the 7 Supreme Guardians, had just begun. The main topic was the humans they believed were responsible for destroying Jinhee and killing the 7th Paladin. Some had tried to track them down, but had failed. Nate Fasai number 4 doubted that the humans were responsible, but Yuriru was convinced that they were, as the area was filled with their stench. Arlo thought that if a paladin had been killed, it must have been the work of a transgender, but either way they were still humans. Svetus was confused as to why they were worried, since they knew the source and cause of the destruction. Tarried. Their number 1 asked if Rishul had any more information, but there was none. As a result, they decided to seal off the city and tighten security in each of their territories. They also decided not to do anything rash, while Tarried ordered Rishul to capture the humans and not let them escape this time. He warned that he had overlooked Rishul's idle behavior the first time, but he might not do so this time. Rishul accepted the order and decided to check out his territory first. Meanwhile, in Busan Harbor, Murray and the others were still loitering around, trying not to be seen by the Zongans as they took them as quietly as possible. They believed that some humans were working for the Zongans in the same area and didn't want to harm them, no matter what. While Garam and Dongho were looking for a boat on one side of the harbor, some Zongans approached them, but luckily Murray took care of them. One of the team wondered where the others were and needed an explanation for not finding a boat. Suddenly he heard a woman's voice. A few Zongans could also be seen talking in a corner of the harbor, one of whom had picked up a woman who was confused about what they were doing, even though she had finished her work for the day. The male Zongan was concerned as to how the female Zongan had managed to bring the lady to this corner, as they saw her as a delicious meal. Their rations had been reduced, which annoyed some of the Zongans, even though their superiors supplied them with human meat every month. Only the executives were allowed to fill their bellies, not the junior Zongans. They were also not allowed to eat the humans in the workforce without permission, so they had no chance of breaking the rules. As they approached the woman, Chan, her child, ran out to protect her. This annoyed the Zongans, but they thought he needed to survive to fill their labor force, so they threw him away. Suddenly, the Zongans were interrupted by another human who rushed in without thinking and didn't know how to fight. This made the Zongans happy, as they saw it as an opportunity to eat more, since a human could not fill them. They approached him and smashed his face in, but were stopped by Murray, who killed them with her writhing brain power. This saved the woman, her child, and the man, but Murray was sad. The man was confused as to why Murray was sad. Suddenly, they received a call that a boat was available and they should all get on it. They wondered how the captain could find the boat, since they had been looking for it for quite some time. As they boarded the boat, the previous guy walked over to Murray, who was sitting alone on the roof. The guy informed Murray that he was also transgender and that his real skill was manipulation. He could change people's emotions just by talking to them. When he tried to test his ability on Murray, it failed, which surprised him. He wondered how his ability could be negated by Murray's extremely bad mood. He then offered to listen to Murray's problems and told her that he also worked as a doctor there. When the man went back to the boat, he met Juho and asked him if he wasn't afraid of Murray. He told Juho that Murray looked like she had no emotions and felt dangerous even though she was scared and wanted to die. From the man's point of view, Murray looked sad, and it was almost as if he was looking for a reason to live instead of wanting to die. Suddenly, a large ship appeared in front of their boat, heading straight for them. From the communication part of the boat, they discovered bodies in Busan Harbor and tried to search nearby ships. The SS Feeder received a call and told them that they had spotted a mysterious fishing boat ahead and would investigate it immediately. They wondered if it was the same fishing boat from the depot, but decided to investigate. However, Zongan on the ship thought it would be too much trouble, so he decided to stay. They ordered the fishing boat to stop, and if they did not cooperate, they would attack. This made Team Fizzle uneasy, so they asked the captain what they should do. She told them she just wanted to sneak past them if possible, as she saw no reason for them to fight since Oriuk Island was right in front of them. Fortunately, Dongho had taken some Zongan work clothes with him for fashion, and they used this as an excuse to wear the clothes while two humans stood behind them. They informed the ship's officer that they were transporting humans to Oryukdo Island. This sounded strange to him, as there was supposed to be no transport that day. But they told him that the humans were additional personnel, which convinced him, as such things happen from time to time. But he was still not entirely convinced when he asked them why humans were exporting humans, since Zongans were supposed to do this kind of work, and this seemed to be their peak. But Dongho Lee had prepared for this. Before the rise of the Zongans, his dream had been to become an actor, a talented actor who would be widely respected, and that helped them when he told the officer that Chiasu Kim had sent them. He knew that at least one of the many workers at the port should be named Chiasu. Zongans used to be human anyway, and it seemed reasonable. The officer asked if the person was still working there, as he had waited a long time to hear from him, and concluded that he was still messing things up, as he hated sending reports. He asked about Chiasu's hair loss and was told it was getting better. Meanwhile, Murray wondered why they could not just kill the officer and move on. Just then, the other Zongans on the ship asked Rishul, the officer, what was going on, as it was already taking too long. He informed the Zongans that the humans had told him that Chiasu had sent them on an errand. Murray thought there was something different about the Zongan. The Zongans also asked if the humans were extra staff, and the officer told them to show respect as this was a senior Zongan in charge of Oriuk Island. The senior Zongan approached Murray and asked if they had met before, but later concluded that he might be imagining things. He ordered the officer to get in so they could leave, but the officer told him to take the others with him as they were going to Oriuk Island after all. The captain whispered to Murray to remember the face of the senior Zongan, as it would not be long before they had to fight him. On Oriuk Island, the human slave farm, they were greeted by the other officers who had been waiting for them at the farm. One of the officers asked who the humans were and was told they were the extra staff. He was ordered to give them some rooms and they were taken away. As they drove, the captain whispered to Dongho again to find some boats they could use if they had to leave. When they got to the rooms, the officer told them that the one in the white hat could go to cell 25, while the other two should go to cell 7. This was indeed a human slave farm, as the name suggested, where human slaves were kept. Some were bred for manual labor, some for special skills, while others were bred to entertain the Zongan. The few humans chosen for these roles were sold to various cities, but most of those who could not be enslaved became human meat. They were sent to the slaughterhouse. If you want to be a chosen slave, you have to show that you are exceptional compared to others and you have to survive. The place was no different from the wild. Caltrain ordered Murray to protect Juho until she gave them further instructions. And they might have to be more careful of the humans than the Zongans in this place. While the captain rested, they went to cell 7, reassuring themselves that the two would be safe as Murray was available there. On her way, she wondered where Jian was. When Murray and Juho entered cell 7, the other inmates attacked them and ordered them to leave. But Murray told them that they were there to save them all and would explain everything in time. The others asked if they had been brought as extra staff, as he thought it was their first time, and then decided to teach them something. He cracked his hand and then hit Juho in the mouth, knocking him to the ground. The man barked at them to stop bullshitting and listen to him, telling them that from that moment on they would be his doormats and would have to give him all the work they were assigned and not tell anyone what they were good at. Juho was shocked when he shouted that they had come to save them all. This made the Sting guy even angrier, as he thought they still didn't get it. He asked if Juho was delusional or something, and as he was about to kick Juho again, Murray blocked his hand with her foot. Then he angrily asked Juho if he could kill the bald guy. This made the guy angry because he was curious if Murray had lost her mind. But Juho on the other side begged Murray not to do it because he shouldn't kill another human being. The bald, burly guy seemed to think that they were delusional and that he wouldn't go easy on them just because they were children. Then, with a flick of her hand, Murray sent the guy flying back. This astonished everyone in the cell, as they hoped that no Zongan had heard the sound and would come in to check on them. Suddenly an officer came in after hearing the sling and asked what was going on, which made Juho freak out because they hadn't done Jian yet and they still had to find a way to rescue the people. It all seemed to be turning into another brawl. When the officer came into the cell, he grabbed the bald man. He asked if he hadn't told him not to cause any more trouble, while the guy pleaded that it wasn't him and claimed it was all a misunderstanding. Promising that it wasn't him this time, it all fell on deaf ears to the officer who thought the bald guy needed some special treatment, so he took him out. It seemed that he had caused trouble before, and Juho was glad that they had somehow gotten through it, but he wondered what treatment the officer had in mind. They weren't going to just kill him anyway, and Juho told Murray not to feel bad because it was all the guy's fault. But when Murray asked what he shouldn't feel bad about, Juho told him not to worry because he wasn't sure how to explain what had happened. As he was about to explain, the older adult in the cell fell to his knees and begged them to spare him, as he hadn't been able to work for so long and feared they would send him to the slaughterhouse. He begged them to spare his life. The other woman in the cell taunted the old man as he knelt, saying he should be ashamed of himself as there were children present and he shouldn't try to save himself now. The old man asked her if she wanted him to end up as human meat, but she told him that wasn't what she was saying. They acted as if Murray and Juho were in charge, so they had to keep on living until the moment they could escape. They assured the duo not to worry as no one would die. They reminded them that they were there to help and rescue them, and promised to help them escape. A man approached Captain Lee and asked if she was new to the place. He volunteered to explain to her how things worked. She told the man that he could take all her work, and if he needed more, she would get him more later, as she needed to rest at the moment. The man wondered how she had known what he wanted and began to rejoice, believing that he would not have to go to the slaughterhouse again. Well, that was what she had expected, and she thought the man should not get too excited as she would get him out soon. The thought of Jian came back to her, and she thought it would be better to look for her now and plan their escape after finding her. Suddenly, there was a broadcast from the loudspeaker in the cell, informing them that it was time to get to work, calling them insects and ordering them to go to their designated work areas and report to their supervisors. The man was happy, seeing this as the perfect time to move, but the voice on the transmission sounded familiar to the captain. Juho was frustrated that he had been assigned the kind of work he was doing while the officers were ordering them to hurry up and keep moving. All this made him doubt if he would be able to find Jian at all and even wonder what work Murray had been assigned. It would be much more tiring than his own, but he still hoped it would be a job that wouldn't annoy him. Meanwhile, Murray was with the tailor, and when he was told to try the machine and sew a cloth, the needle pierced his hand. So the man who was working on him ordered him to sit and watch from a distance, while a lady went to get some plasters and asked if his hand was all right. She actually helped him to put the plaster on, but he told her he didn't need it. And this upset the lady, who asked him what he was talking about and told him that the wound could get infected without the plaster. She also asked his name, and told him that his name was Marion. She then thanked him for the last time as their cell could now get back to work as the bald man had taken all their work and they were afraid they would be taken to the slaughterhouse. Just then a lady named Jison came and called the other girl next to Marie as Hey and introduced Jison to Marie as a good person and the only person in her cell who cared about her. She had also fought for her against the bald guy. The other cells seemed to be even worse, probably because there was a lot of competition. Of course, they also had to deal with the bald guy, but even that was still a bit better than other cells, and it was getting even better at the moment, all thanks to Murray. He had helped them in many ways, and Jison was grateful. But Murray wasn't willing to listen to her talk and he just got up and left, to the astonishment of Jison, who wondered what was wrong and why he didn't say anything. Meanwhile, the captain had been looking for Jian and had also thought that she was not there. She had looked for her everywhere, in the file, in the workshop and even in the detention cells, but she could not find her anywhere. That didn't sound good. Had she missed something? She wondered if Jian had left yet. While she was thinking about the situation, she heard the broadcast again, telling them that it was time for work and they had to finish whatever they were doing. She folded her hands and thought, something about this voice sounds familiar. It can't be Jian. She traced the voice as it ordered them to report to their superiors and return to their cells. As the captain pondered whether the person in front of her was Jian, her cellmate came in, happy to have worked hard that day. Curious, the captain asked him if he knew where the Zongans were sending the announcements from. He told her that the information came from the guard room. Sue asked him if she could work there. The man looked at her in a low tone and asked what she was talking about. Cleaning the guard room was his job, and he asked about the day she had promised him earlier so he could take over her job. She gave him a gentle kick in the mouth while pleading for a proper apology later, and then left. As she approached the entrance to the guard room, she saw a guard snoring. She tried to wake him, but he was too relaxed. She realized that their security was so lax that they felt they didn't need to keep their guard up around humans. And more importantly, she hoped that Jian was in there. Fortunately, when she entered the room, she saw a lady sitting with her head on the desk. Captain Lee concluded that it was Jian and was happy. Although she had never thought that Jian could become a guard because the situation favored her, it was Jian. Jian explained that Sue had been caught during an investigation and had worked really hard to survive and somehow ended up in this position. When the captain tried to convince her of their escape plan, Jian was shocked when she told Captain Lee that there was no way for them to escape. Meanwhile, in the other cell, Murray, Juho and their cellmates were discussing how to get to know each other better. They decided to write down their goals now that they didn't have to worry about the bald man anymore. Juho thought about how carefree they could be at that time. When he thought about it, he had not been able to talk to Murray that much. He should use this as a chance to get to know him better. They all agreed to participate in the fun game. Even Grandpa, who was sitting there feeling depressed, they all started to write down their goals, what they wanted to achieve and a short explanation for it. Juho was surprised to see Murray writing something down as well. He wondered what he was going to write. After writing down their goals, they started with Grandpa, who said he wanted to see his grandchildren. Since the world had changed, he hadn't been able to see them, and he wanted to see them at least once more before he died. He hoped they were still alive and felt sorry that he hadn't been able to see them and had only been a burden to all his cellmates. Next was Jaisan, who wanted to cook a meal. They hadn't been able to trust humans or Zongans for years, so she wanted to meet some good people and share a nice meal with them. Next was Hayan, who informed them that there was someone she wanted to get closer to, but she didn't tell them the name of the person. After Hayan was Juho, who couldn't think of anything and suggested that they skip him and go to Murray. Now it was Murray's turn and Juho wondered what he had written down. He saw that Murray had written so much and would have a lot to say. Unfortunately, Murray told them that he wanted to die. This revelation shocked everyone except Juho, who had known Murray before. Murray explained that he had killed his mother on a cold winter's day, but it was all for her sake. In a flashback, Murray is telling the tragic story of his life. He is with his mom, who adores him for being so cute. She tells him that he can be a president someday because he is so polite. Murray's mother starts laughing after teasing him and suddenly starts coughing. Murray asks her if she is not well, but she tells him that she is fine. Murray's mother tells him to go home, and she leaves for some work while Murray watches her from behind, sensing that she is sick. Murray insists on going with her, feeling a strange premonition that he won't see his mother again. His mother takes Murray with her and they start doing her work. She is motivated today because she has her son with her. As Murray is too tired that day, the occasional customers and surrounding noises lull him to sleep, but he is having the best time with his mother. While Murray is sleeping, his mother feels sick again. She knows something is wrong. Murray wakes up and asks his mother if she is okay. He wants to call a doctor, but she refuses, telling him to close the shop early so she can rest a bit. After getting home, Murray's mother is cooking and Murray feels relieved to see her fine. They eat food together while Murray's mother tells him she has a present for him. She got him a new uniform as his previous clothes and uniforms were worn out or donated. Murray becomes so happy and wants to try on his new uniform. It's a little big for his size, but he still wears it and feels so happy that he wants to sleep in the present his mother gave him. At almost 12:15 a.m., a midnight announcement is made for the citizens about a human disaster that occurred in the South Korean region. The broadcast tells everyone to stay at home. Murray wakes up and starts calling for his mother. Her bed is full of blood as she coughs blood. When Murray calls out to her, she turns back in the shape of a monster. Murray gets scared after seeing his mother's face. She jumps on Murray and starts biting his neck until his clothes are torn and he starts bleeding. He screams and asks his mom to stop, and suddenly realizes he is having a dream. He turns his neck to see his mother's bed and realizes that he isn't dreaming, and the woman who wants to eat him is actually his mother, who is now a zombie. He begs his mother to stop, but she doesn't. Murray pushes her away, and suddenly she bumps into the wall. Murray runs outside, calling for help, only to witness the destruction all around him. Fear consumes him as he realizes it's not a dream but a horrifying reality. He sees some people turning into zombies, while others who are still human discuss ways to escape. A woman approaches him, ready to bite, and he screams in terror, running away and desperately seeking help. Another zombie attacks him and bites his arm. Filled with anger, Murray pulls his arm away, causing it to separate from his body and begin bleeding. He collapses in a corner, calling out for his mom, when he sees his mother approaching him. Terrified, he begs her to stop and stay away. His mother draws closer, and Murray screams. Suddenly, bones from his body pierce his mother, causing her to scream in agony. She embraces Murray, apologizing to him. Murray is overwhelmed with sorrow as he realizes that he has killed his own mother. He wants to deny it, but the truth is undeniable. A male zombie hears Murray's voice and lunges at him. As the other zombies see Murray's face, they freeze in shock. Murray pleads with the zombies to kill him because he has killed his own mother. However, they mock him, and one zombie even attempts to eat his heart, but Murray doesn't die. The zombies are shocked and flee from him. In a fit of anger, Murray wakes up and begins brutally killing the remaining zombies, causing them to scatter. Murray reminisces about his mother giving him a new uniform as he walks aimlessly, muttering the word mom. He roams without purpose for days, weeks, and even years, wishing for death. Those listening to his story fall silent, unsure of how to comfort him. Miss Jison tells Murray that he looks pathetic because he doesn't know what his mother would want for him, only desiring his own demise. Murray argues that it's natural to want to die after killing his own mother. Miss Jison tries to reason with him, explaining that harming himself is not the answer. As she speaks, Murray's anger intensifies, causing the room to shake in an earthquake. Concerned, everyone tries to calm him down, and Jison tells Murray that his mother apologized before her death because she knew he would struggle and have to live without a parent. She advises him to let go of the image of his mother he holds in his heart as the only way to offer her an apology. While Murray listens to Miss Jison, he imagines his own mother speaking those words to him. The earthquake subsides, leaving the old man astonished to learn that the young student caused it. Meanwhile, Miss Jion, a renowned scientist, informs Captain Lee Kyung that escaping this place is impossible until they kill Chief Rishiru. She explains that there is a barrier surrounding the camp, allowing entry but not allowing freedom to leave. Rishiru is the one behind it, which means they have to confront and defeat him to escape. Lee Kyung recalls Chin Murray's statement about the human breeding farm being under the chief's jurisdiction, making it logical for the facility to restrict movement. Miss Jian is impressed by the commander's understanding. Suddenly, an alarm sounds, grabbing Miss Jian's attention. Lee asks about the noise, and Jian explains that it's a device she created in the past to erase short-term memory. It also serves as an alarm for shift changes. Commander Nur reassures Lee Kyung, reminding her that even in this chaotic world, they have squad members who share their determination. A boy named Hoyoung arrives with papers to meet Miss Jian. As they talk, one of the zombies overhears Lee and Hoyoung and lunges towards them. Lee Kyung swiftly fights back, using her impressive combat skills. Despite Hoyoung and Jian's attempts to stop her, Lee relentlessly beats the zombie, eventually erasing its memory with the stick Jian made. Lee proudly declares that she can take on 100 zombies by herself and mentions that there is a child in their group who is even stronger than her. Hoyoung, astonished by Lee's fighting abilities, starts to believe in her and joins their group, although he still harbors some doubts about the stranger. Lee Kyung informs Hoyoung of their plan to escape and rescue all the humans trapped in the camp. However, Hoyoung suggests they should only take a few with them due to the large number of humans held captive. Lee tries to persuade him, and eventually, Hoyoung agrees, convinced by witnessing Lee's impressive combat skills. Hoyoung then shares his plan, explaining that escaping from the camp is relatively easy due to the lax security. The real problem lies in the overwhelming fear humans have towards the zombies, making them hesitant to fight back. Hoyoung instructs Lee Kyung that even if she tells the others to follow her, no one will, given the fear instilled by Chief Rishiru. Curious, Lee Kyung asks Hoyoung about Rishiru's whereabouts, surprising him. The next morning, during a meeting to find the culprit responsible for killing Paladin, all the zombies and humans gather. Lee Kyung sees this as the perfect opportunity to confront Rishiru and help eliminate the fear among the humans. Lee and her group, including Murray, stand among the humans in the meeting. As Lee stands at the front of the line, a man behind her tells her to move so others can pass. Ignoring him, the man grabs Lee's shoulder, prompting her to scream loudly and command Garam to start the boat for their escape. Responding to Lee's voice, Garam quickly begins to move. The humans around Lee brand her as insane for her outburst. A zombie approaches Lee, seemingly about to say something, but she slaps him so hard he falls to the ground. Chaos erupts, and a man with prominent ears and hair enters, the chief, Rishiru. Angrily, Rishiru accuses Lee of killing Paladin. Lee boldly retorts that she is there to free all the humans. The surrounding humans become bewildered, knowing this seems impossible. Rishiru orders her to be silent, growing angrier as Lee confidently challenges him. Rishiru prepares to unleash his full power and attack Lee Kyung, but she suddenly claims that she is not the one who killed Paladin. She leaves Rishiru in Murray's hands and urges all the humans to escape as quickly as possible. They start running, and the Zongans give chase, shouting at each other to close the doors. Lee Kyung tells Hoyoung to leave her and assist the others in the escape plan. Hoyoung and the members of Lee's group start running, facing hundreds of Zongans alone. Lee Kyung emphasizes that the lives of the humans behind her are more important than her own. Her words enrage the Zongans. Meanwhile, Rishiru stands before Murray, questioning whether he is an additional staff member on the boat or a leader. Murray shows no interest in his words and simply states that he is unsure of what the others said about the new era. Irritated by Murray's indifference, Rishiru demands that he leave, but Murray refuses. Rishiru becomes angry, and as Murray and Rishiru continue their intense battle, Jaisan approaches from behind, catching Murray's attention. He warns her to stay away, aware of the danger in their surroundings. Rishiru seizes the opportunity to attack Jaisan, but Murray swiftly intervenes, using his hand to shield her from harm. Concerned, Jaisan asks Murray if he is okay. Rishiru inquires about Jaisan, and Murray retaliates, launching another attack. Suddenly, Heian emerges with an elderly human who had not yet evacuated. Jaisan takes Heian and the old man to safety while Rishiru is momentarily distracted. Amidst the fierce battle, Rishiru grows surprised by the relentless and powerful strikes delivered by Murray, realizing that something has triggered him. Murray taps into his full force, soaring through the sky and descending with tremendous force, forcefully punching Rishiru. Severely injured, Rishiru accepts his impending death, content to die at the hands of Murray. However, Murray reveals that he will not kill him. After uttering these words, Murray departs when Captain Lee informs him that all the humans have been evacuated and urges him to join them. Murray leaves Rishiru alive, as he only renders his opponents unconscious. Captain Lee and the others observe Murray's departure, and Rishiru faints. Garam informs Captain Lee that the boat is about to depart, bringing joy to the humans who finally realize they are escaping. Meanwhile, Murray, carrying the bound body of Rishiru, and Miss Jaisan stand nearby. Jaisan begins to express her appreciation to Murray, but he instructs her to stay on standby. Jaisan thanks Murray for saving her earlier and asks how he manages to continue living without his mother. In response, Murray advises her to live with the purpose of finding her family members and embracing happiness. The captain and the others are surprised to learn that Murray is enduring a personal tragedy while striving to survive in a world where his mother is absent. Captain Lee feels remorseful and admits to using Murray as a temporary ally to achieve her goals. She offers him the opportunity to become a member of the squad. But before accepting, she asks Murray if he still desires death. Murray responds affirmatively, leaving everyone astonished once again. As Captain Lee and the others proceed on foot, with Murray trailing behind, he contemplates the meaning of hope for everyone. Meanwhile, Garam guides the humans to safety in a boat, and a sense of peace washes over them after a prolonged period of hardship. Captain Lee attempts to extract information from Rishiru, but he stubbornly refuses to reveal anything. Undeterred, Captain Lee instructs Juho to employ his magic spell to compel Rishiru to talk. However, Rishiru claims that they have nothing to gain from him, but he believes there is a significant opportunity for him if he aligns himself with them. When Captain Lee inquires about this opportunity, Rishiru expresses his admiration for his master, Murray, and expresses his desire to join their side. Juho is unhappy with the way Captain Lee is dealing with Rishiru, continuously urging her not to trust this monster. Rishiru reveals the existence of an island near Oryukdo Island where they can safely hide the humans. When Captain Lee asks about the location, Rishiru refuses to disclose it and insists on personally taking them there. Juho tries to stop Lee, but she doesn't listen and agrees with Rishiru, forbidding him from attacking humans in return. Captain Lee asks Rishiru to lead them to the island, disregarding Juho's objections. She reassures Juho that Murray will protect him if needed, but Juho remains dissatisfied with the captain's decision and wonders about her true intentions for justice. Jian asks Rishiru about the barricade on Oryukdo Island, but he tells her to wait until they reach the island. Upon arrival, they find only a small piece of land with a single tree, causing confusion and blame towards Rishiru. Captain Lee becomes angry. But Rishiru instructs her to press a stone, assuring her that it will reveal their purpose for being there. As soon as Captain Lee presses the button, both she and Rishiru are thrust deep into the sea, revealing numerous hidden houses. Rishiru explains that these houses will be sufficient to accommodate all the humans. Satisfied with the location, Captain Lee questions why she ordered Murray to attack Rishiru if she possesses such power. Captain Lee admits to having her own reasons and clarifies that she isn't as powerful as Rishiru claims. They return to the island, and Captain Lee instructs the group members to assist the unpacking while asking the squad members to follow her. Captain Lee leads the group members to their designated living area, accompanied by Commander Nori and Murray. Nori is angry at Lee for the way she ordered Murray to bring her back. Captain Lee inquires about the boat they sailed on, and Murray reveals that he threw it away, surprising everyone. Captain Lee advises everyone to rest before reconvening. After resting, Commander Nori gathers everyone and commends them for the successful mission at Oryuko Island. She announces their plan to use this place as their starting point and adopt the name Deadly Regime invented by Lee Kai. The research lab becomes their new headquarters, and Nori discusses future plans. Nori asks Rishiru about the current head of the Red Team, but he explains that only the leader knows their whereabouts. Nori decides to dismantle the foundation of the Red Team based on the information provided by Rishiru. Commander Nori establishes ranks according to their plan. Rank 5 is Urira, Rank 4 is Nate Fesh, Rank 3 is Arrow, Rank 2 is Spedus, and Rank 1 is Tarot. After announcing the initiation of the Chief Hunt mission, Nori decides to attack Rank 5 and Rank 4 first. Changwon, known as the Zongan Training Camp, is under their control and houses all the military weapons. This mission won't be easy, but success will grant them an excellent outpost. From there, they aim to develop a strong force that doesn't rely solely on Murray. Nori acknowledges the need to sustain human society even if Murray is no longer present, but Captain Lee has different plans for Murray. Jian asks Commander Nori about their plans after the mission's success. Nori explains that if other Zongans become aware of their attack on Changwon, they will retaliate, but the city's strong defense system will make invasion difficult. Rishiru warns them that Rank 1, who holds weapons and formidable force, is guarding Changwon. Commander Nori acknowledges the potential risks of their plan but emphasizes that if they succeed, they will become strong enough to establish human territory from there. Kyuho remains confused about Rishiru's intentions and his allegiance to Murray. He believes Rishiru is lying and fears that they will be destroyed once they enter Changwon. Rishiru assures Kyuho that he is only providing information and urges him not to dismiss his love for Murray's master. However, Rishiru also has his own motives. Commander Nori calms Kyuho down and assures him that they will conduct an investigation before proceeding with the operation. If they discover that Rishiru's information is false, they will devise a new plan. The commander orders everyone to strengthen their forces by recruiting strong individuals from the humans they rescued on Oryuko Island and report back to her once they have made their selection. Jian is researching in the lab and is curious about the advanced technology present on the island, which predates the apocalypse by hundreds of years. Captain Lee and Murray approach Jian with a request to create a weapon that can kill Murray, similar to the knife used before to slow Murray's healing process. Jian is surprised by the request and questions Lee, stating that she has to make a weapon to fulfill Murray's wish. Jian calls Captain Lee closer to discuss the material needed for the weapon. She reveals her research on the Rani flower, which she discovered after the apocalypse. Extracting Rani from the flower and combining it with metal can make the metal significantly stronger, allowing them to create various weapons. Additionally, the metal can be used to kill Murray. Captain Lee instructs Murray to assist in finding the Rani flower. The next morning, Murray takes Garam and Sunbi with him, flying in the sky. Sunbi is scared, while Garam examines the map provided by Jian, which marks the location of the Rani flower. They locate the place called Chinsiong Mountain and land there. Their mission is to find the Rani flower, and the three of them work diligently. While exploring, Sunbi encounters a Zongan and screams in fear. It turns out to be a Zongan's body with paint on it. Garam suggests investigating the area for any signs of humans. They discover the body of a child under a tree, also covered in the same paint. Garam contemplates that this could be the work of a superhuman, someone dangerous who merges Zongans and humans. Sunbi mentions a rumor he heard about a crazy scientist conducting such experiments. Garam dismisses the rumor, urging them not to dwell on it. Sunbi remains scared, having never encountered something like this before. Garam is also fearful but focuses on completing the mission before returning, as it was Captain Lee's assignment. Garam orders Sunbi and Murray to follow her in their search for the Rani flower. Despite their efforts, they don't find a single petal. Garam becomes frustrated and declares she will burn the mountain if necessary. Eventually, they decide to rest. Sunbi suggests that Murray sleep, but Murray chooses to stay on guard throughout the night. Karam feels it's unfair that he doesn't need sleep, considering all she has done during their missions. She realizes she isn't as strong as Captain Lee or as smart as the Chief Commander. While Garam shares her thoughts with Murray and Sunbi, they hear the loud voice of a zombie attacking a child. Garam swiftly saves the child by slapping the Zongan. The Zongan recognizes Garam as a trap killer and attacks her. Garam fights back using her extraordinary powers, engaging the Zongan alone until Sunbi and Murray arrive. Garam instructs Murray to save the child, but he remains motionless, refusing to help Garam. Just as the Zongan grabs Garam by the head and demands to know the location of the hidden humans, a boy with long hair wielding a yellow ochre arrives to save her. The child identifies himself as Kim Min-sung, the hero of their village. After introducing himself, Kim offers them to take some rest in the village as they are injured. Boo Garam refuses to go, stating they have other matters to attend to. Sunbi also wants to rest, but Garam doesn't listen and continues on. Meanwhile, Kim enters his village with the rescued child, and everyone praises him. He reunites the child with their parents and tells them to head back. Garam continues to stalk Kim as he enters the village, growing suspicious of the preferential treatment he received. Garam continues to follow Kim and instructs Sunbi to do as he pleases, leaving him confused. Garam overhears Kim mentioning the word combine and becomes frightened, recalling the rumors about the mad scientist who merges humans and zombies. Driven by suspicion, Garam decides to enter and attack Kim as soon as possible. She smashes through the door and launches an attack. But Kim grabs Garam's foot, calling her a kind and strong person. Kim proceeds to explain everything from the beginning. As a child, Kim mistakenly killed Zongans, leading the villagers to label him a hero. The praise made Kim happy, prompting them to set traps for Zongans and gain further admiration. Initially skeptical, Garam starts to believe Kim after he describes the trap set for Zongan. Kim asks Garam for help because a Zongan recently threatened to come to Changwon and capture him. Kim seeks their assistance in capturing that Zongan. During their conversation, they hear someone calling Garam the trap killer. When Kim hears people shouting that a Zongan has entered the village, they quickly rush outside to confront the threat. They encounter a powerful female Zongan who has entered the village to capture the trap killer. Garam follows Kim, ready to support them in battle. Garam also informs Sunbi and Murray about the situation. As the villagers see the female Zongan, panic ensues, and people start fleeing. The Zongan mercilessly kills and wounds the villagers with her sword. The desperate cries for the heroes help fill the air. Kim appears with a palette of colors and a paintbrush, intending to aid the people, but feels devastated by the sight of the dead and injured. The Zongan strikes Kim on the head, leaving them injured and concerned about the villagers. With one final attack imminent, Garam rushes in to rescue Kim and the people, shocked by the state of the village. Sunbi and Murray also arrive at the scene. Garam and the Zongan prepare to fight, but the Zongan effortlessly blocks Garam's attack. Garam realizes that she cannot match the strength of such a formidable opponent. She instructs Sunbi and Murray to help the injured villagers and evacuate them. However, the Zongan warns the people that any movement will result in them being cut down by her sword. She introduces herself as Jai So-ki, the captain of Squad 3 from the Changwon defense team. Jai So-ki challenges Garam, forcing her into a fight to the death. Murray, standing still, has a flashback of his conversation with Captain Lee, who warned him not to assist Garam under any circumstances. Captain Lee emphasized that if Garam were to perish, it would signify the end of her journey. Murray remembers these words as he watches Garam engage in a life-or-death battle with Jai So-ki. Garam, exhausted from the intense fight, collapses onto the ground amidst a field of flowers. Murray stands before her, and for the first time, Garam asks him for help. With a smile, Murray extends his hand, and Garam grasps it tightly. Murray lifts Garam onto his shoulder, and they find themselves in a flower garden. Kim rushes over, his mouth still stained with blood, concerned about Garam's well-being. Garam advises him to tend to his own wounds first. After some time, they arrive at a location abundant with rainy flowers. A woman offers them the flowers, mentioning their lack of practical use and tastelessness. Sunbi collects the flowers, and the following morning, they prepare to return to headquarters. Kim requests Garam's assistance in relocating the villagers to a safe place. Garam assures him that they will be taken to a secure location. But for the time being, they must remain in a temporary shelter. Excitement fills Garam as she looks forward to reporting the mission's success to Captain Lee. Before departing, the villagers express their urgency to be taken to safety. Garam reassures them and entrusts Kim with a wireless phone in case of emergencies. Initially hesitant, Kim declines the phone, believing that he isn't a true hero and that others might suffer because of him. However, Garam commends his bravery for immediately rushing to protect the villagers upon hearing about the zombie. The people and Garam praise Kim once again. After a brief absence, Kim returns with a newfound determination to safeguard the villagers and lead them to a temporary safe haven. With a smile on her face, Garam enters headquarters, where Captain Lee awaits, watching their arrival with a smile of her own. Since obtaining the Ranyi flower, significant changes have been made to the Death Square quarters. The village now has access to disaster relief supplies, food, clothing, and a substantial amount of resources. Advanced development has taken place, including the utilization of the weapons in their possession. Humans have also undergone military training. The time flies by quickly, and Captain Lee gathers everyone, assuring them that their recent efforts won't betray them. In the next 7 days, they will launch an invasion on Changwon. Simultaneously, a Zongan sitting on Oryukdo Island is surprised to find it vanished. Rank 4 of the defense team, Nate Fesh, receives news of Oryukdo Island's destruction from a Zongan who landed there. He relays the information over the phone, raising concerns about Rishiru. This Zongan is enraged and eager to kill humans to refine his rusty martial arts skills. Nate also reveals that Jai So-ki is alive and residing in the Chinsong Mountains, seeking to regain her powers for revenge. Meanwhile, in the Dead Square headquarters, a match ensues between Team Murray and Team Rishiru. The objective is for the defenders to snatch the flag first, with the winning team receiving a box of prawn crackers. Choi Juho leads Murray's team, while Hoan leads Rishiru's. Murray finds himself with an ardent fan who calls him master. Rishiru and the girl begin to fight, each wanting Murray as their master. Murray successfully snatches the flag, securing another victory. Captain Lee and Jian discuss the Ranyi swords made with Ranyi flowers, which enhance humans' powers, turning them into superhumans. Captain asks Jian about her progress in finding the best way to kill Murray, but she hasn't discovered it yet. Captain proposes that Jian join her for a special mission today since they require Murray for various tasks. She believes that developing humanity within Murray is crucial for their cooperation. During a test, Jian asks Murray if he feels any difference, but he denies it. Thus, Jian's 250th experiment on Murray also fails. Captain Lee asks Miss Jaison and Hoyin to assist Murray for the day. They take Murray to the kitchen and suggest making curry together. Miss Jaison asks Murray to fetch the ingredients for the curry, as it's her dream to cook for him. Murray and Hoyin head out to buy groceries. Meanwhile, Garam is talking to Miss Seong on the wireless phone, assuring him that they will bring him back once the Changwon plan is complete. Hoyin and Murray knock on Garam's door, asking for carrots, but Garam insists she doesn't have any. Murray playfully points at her hair, calling them carrots, which angers Garam, prompting her to kick them out of the room. Hoyin asks an old man for the location of carrots, leading them to a carrot field tended by the old man, much to Hoyin's delight. Murray gathers some carrots, and they inquire about potatoes. The old man mentions a potato-like creature swimming in the ocean. Murray and Hoyin venture to the ocean to capture the potato-like creatures. However, they discover it is a fish resembling a potato. Their attempt to catch it is thwarted when a shark devours the fish. Murray defeats the shark and returns it to the ocean. The fish they manage to carry is so large that every human present helps Murray and Hoyin carry it inside. Miss Jaison must now prepare curry for everyone in the headquarters. However, when they taste it, everyone vomits as it isn't good. Encouraged by Murray's mother always telling him not to skip meals, he takes a spoonful of the curry and tastes it. Excitement fills the air as Murray eats food for the first time. And when asked about the taste, he says it's bad. Everyone starts teasing Miss Jaison. Captain Lee smiles, as this was all part of their plan to make Murray happy. Garam from headquarters informs Min Seong about the upcoming Changwon plan, assuring him that it will be carried out soon. However, the wireless phone given to Min Seong is taken by a Zongan member from the 4th rank who landed on the island. He demands that Garam deactivate all the defense shields and meet him in person. Recognizing the person behind the phone as Yur-Yur, Garam inquires about Min Seong, but Yur-Yur destroys the phone and flees. Garam shares this information with everyone, including Rishiru. Rishiru explains that Yur-Yur's obsession with becoming stronger is different from his own, causing concern as their plan has now been exposed. Without saying anything, Garam departs, but the captain understands that Garam seeks revenge for the villagers in Min Seong. The commander updates everyone about the situation and the plan, but they realize that Murray is missing. Miss Jaison discovers Murray sitting silently under a tree. He had gone there to dispose of the curry. Miss Jaison consoles Murray, reminding him of the happy memories they are creating and encouraging him not to dwell on negative thoughts. Murray leaves, acknowledging that the curry wasn't that bad, leaving Jaison with a smile. Following that, the distinguished members have begun to ignite like a fuse as humans take their small steps toward a great journey. A week later, humans enter Changwon, where Zongans eagerly await their arrival, intending to feast on them. News of the human invasion spreads throughout Changwon, and the captains of the Zongan squad start attacking the humans. Captain and the others anxiously wait for Murray to arrive, and he does just in time. The total number of members is 336, including the defense squad captain and low-rank Zongan squad members. The distance from the barricade gate to Yuryu's control center is 3.2 kilometers. Murray eliminates a total of 678 Zongans during the journey, taking only 3 seconds. He arrives directly to confront Yuryu, the one who killed Minxiang. When Yuryu questions how Murray managed to pass through the main gate's Zongans, Murray casually reveals that he killed them, leaving Yuryu shocked. Yuryu, still in disbelief and contemplating how this human managed to defeat powerful Zongans, attempts to attack Murray with his most dangerous tactic. However, Murray remains unscathed, unaware that he is actually fighting Yuryu. This further surprises Yuryu. When Yuryu reveals his identity, Murray intensifies his attacks with even greater force. Now, humans are set to infiltrate Changwon by entering the area cleared by Murray. Captain assigns Garam the task of rescuing all the humans inside, while she herself heads to the supercluster in the center of Changwon, as revealed by Rishiru. The captain activates all her powers for the upcoming battle, vowing that no human will die under her watch. The experimental woman, Nate Fesh, grows frustrated with the errors she encounters during her experiments. Upon being informed about the human invasion, she activates the defense protocol and the pincet offer system. She urgently sends an alert to Terret, the strongest among them all. On the other side, Garam fiercely takes care of the Zongans, determined to rescue the humans. In the week leading up to the attack, humans were filled with terror, but now they fight back against the Zongans with strength and determination, and Garam is no exception. The Zongans, who are unaware of Han's attack, continue to transfer humans for work shifts. Hansol Yuna, known as the uncle of the kids in Changwon, notices two boys named Jeonjiak and Jangan who are visibly stressed and can't even remember their own names. Hansol kindly advises them that the Zongans fear the potential of humans and encourages them to fight until their potential blooms. Hansol embraces the kids. And just then, Garam arrives in the area with a dead Zongan, urging everyone to follow her. When Uncle Hansol realizes that the humans are here to save them, he instructs everyone to follow Garam and rushes off to collect his belongings before leaving. Witnessing Hansol's bravery, Garam feels motivated and begins assisting people. Hansol enters his room to retrieve his books and belongings. But suddenly, the roof collapses due to the activation of the defense protocol, which targets humans. Captain Lee notices the flying clippers, which were sent to attack humans, and realizes their power source is the research headquarters where Nate Fesh is located. The captain orders everyone to seek shelter inside buildings. Captain asks Garam to take action against Nate Fesh. Though scared, Garam receives support from the captain. She runs towards the research headquarters but gets intercepted by Jai Soki, the Zongan who was severely injured by Garam during the Rani Flower mission. Zongan Ki is filled with fury, seeking revenge for her beauty and friends. She attacks Garam with her sword. In her desperation, Garam calls for Captain Lee's help. Hearing Garam's plea, the captain appears and engages in a brief fight with Ki. However, she informs Garam that she will send reinforcements through Himi. Garam is surprised that the captain refuses to fight alongside her and orders her to proceed to the research headquarters. Just as Zongan Ki is about to attack Garam again, Juho, along with Rishiru, arrives as backup. Juho informs Garam that he has placed a device around Rishiru's neck, allowing him to control Rishiru's actions. When Rishiru and Zongan Ki see each other, they are both taken aback. Garam instructs Juho to handle Ki, but as she attempts to leave, Ki attacks her once more. This time, Rishiru steps in to stop Ki's attack and supports Garam, further enraging Ki. Ki and Rishiru engage in a fight, with Ki overpowering Rishiru and continuing to pursue Garam. Upon realizing the situation, Juho activates a function to awaken Rishiru and commands him to fight Ki. Rishiru gets up and attacks Ki, but she strikes back, causing him to fall again. Rishiru asks Juho for medicine, but Hoyoung refuses, stating that it can only be used in a crisis. However, Rishiru manages to manipulate Juho and obtains the medicine. After consuming it, he regains his true form and strength. Hoyoung orders Rishiru to go and fight Zongan Ki, but Rishiru refuses, stating that he has something else to do. He leaves, praising Juho for giving him the medicine. Juho believes that Rishiru is going to betray the humans now. However, Rishiru surprises him by heading towards Ki and engaging in a fierce battle with her. The medicine given to Rishiru is made from Murray's blood, which possesses healing abilities and can regenerate clothes. However, its effects only last for 1 hour, specifically for living Zongans. As Rishiru fights Kiyi, his appearance returns, surprising Juho, who had doubted him. Juho learns the truth about Rishiru's legendary status as a Freddian, a Zongan with superpowers, from years ago. During the intense battle with Kiyi, Juho activates his powers and assists Rishiru in killing her. Rishiru expresses excitement to meet Master Murray, and Juho realizes his initial misconception about Rishiru. Juho admires Murray's bravery for overpowering a powerful Zongan like Ki effortlessly. Meanwhile, Murray continues his fight with Yurira. Murray uses Yurira's spine as a weapon and withstands her attacks. Shocking her, Yurira questions why Murray hasn't killed him yet, but Murray reveals he is only ordered to kill officials and nothing more. During their battle, Murray asks Yurira which part of the past she wants to forget, leaving her confused. Yurira shares her childhood story, recounting the peak competition between Zongans and Seoul and her subsequent loss of her father. She expresses gratitude to Murray for listening, as she had never shared her past with anyone before. Murray glimpses his own past life through Yurira's story. While Murray wants to show respect and gratitude towards her, he lets go of his past and resumes attacking Yurira. Despite Yurira's relentless tactics, Murray blocks her moves. Their fight turns into a unique conversation, where they find a sense of comfort and connection. Yurira considers it an honor to be Murray's opponent and suggests they leave together. But Murray employs his final tactic to kill her, causing Changwon to shake. Captain Lee and the other humans notice the disturbance caused by Murray. Murray makes his last move and stops fighting back. Yurira, in her final moments, expresses that if she were human, she would have been his friend, and Murray agrees. After her last words, Yurira vanishes, and Murray imagines her going with her father. Meanwhile, Natefesh experiences errors in his experiments and becomes annoyed. Garam appears and engages in a fight with Natefesh, while Captain Lee experiences strange sensations in her chest. Natefesh shoots Garam in the head, attempting to turn her into a Zongan, but she manages to save herself, revealing her status as a superhuman. Natefesh realizes Garam's true nature and becomes more enraged. He uses the power of Spinal Breaker to control Garam's brain, resulting in a shared consciousness. As Natefesh gains control over Garam's mind, he forces her to remain still and shoots at her. However, Sunbee steps in front of Garam, sacrificing his life to save her. Sunbee urges Garam to escape and tells her not to die there. Rishiru, Himi, and Kim witness this heartbreaking moment. Captain Lee, despite the exhaustion of the humans, remains undeterred and continues fighting. As Sunbee takes his last breath as a human, time seems to freeze for Garam. She recalls the moments she shared with Sunbee, his unwavering support and care for her. Despite his lack of strength, Sunbee has always been a pillar of support for Garam. Fueled by anger, Garam attempts to attack Natefesh, but Sunbee, now turned into a Zongan, attacks her instead. After killing Yurira, Murray decides to join Captain Lee in the battle against Natefesh. Captain Lee feels relief and the human forces receive a significant boost. The tide shifts from defense to offense. Garam shoots a bullet and instructs Murray to follow it, as it will lead him to Natefesh's location. Kim reports the situation to Captain Lee, who takes charge and leads everyone directly towards their objective. Murray follows the bullet's path and confronts Natefesh. When Zongan Sunbee attacks Murray, he retaliates and knocks him to the ground. Natefesh attempts to use the Spinal Breaker on Murray, but it fails to control him. Natefesh adapts and learns Murray's abilities and powers through their shared brain. She discovers Murray's weak point, which is his mother, and manipulates his mind by creating a hallucination involving her. Meanwhile, Captain Lee hears voices and discovers Miss Jaisan and Haiyan helping someone underground. They explain their presence and inform Captain Lee about their mission. Captain Lee takes them along and discovers that the person they were helping is Uncle Hansel. When Captain tries to assist him, he hands her a list containing the names of the humans who have been working in Changwon since the beginning but have forgotten their names. Uncle Hansel entrusts Captain Lee with the task of finding these individuals and reminding them of their true identity. Captain Lee is deeply impressed by Hansol's determination and provides him with medical treatment, expressing the need for people like him in their society. Meanwhile, Natefesh attempts to manipulate Murray using his mother, but Murray sees through the illusion and launches a powerful attack. Natefesh loses the will to continue fighting, and her last words are "Oh no." With Natefesh defeated, the humans grow stronger together and continue progressing towards completing their mission. The mission proceeds smoothly. Hansol's calculations reveal that there are 426 enslaved humans in Changwon and 52 members of the Death Squad. He expresses gratitude to everyone for their efforts. They emerge victorious after 13 hours and 23 minutes of battle. The Changwon operation concludes with a triumphant success for the humans. Captain Lee asks for Hansol's name, and he introduces himself as Jin Jawoon. Upon hearing Garam's voice, Jin Jawoon realizes that she is his daughter. Garam also attempts to recognize her father, but the pressing situation prevents them from having a proper moment to do so. Despite the circumstances, they grow closer and ask each other if they are truly seeing each other. Overwhelmed with emotion, Garam hurriedly embraces her father as soon as they both recognize each other. This heartfelt reunion brings immense joy to everyone present, especially Captain Lee, who watches the touching moment with admiration. Garam takes Sunbi, who has been transformed into a Zongan, for treatment. Meanwhile, Captain Lee and Juho are attending to the injured patients. Miss Jisan and Hyun spot Murray and excitedly embrace him, expressing how much they've missed him. Instead of becoming annoyed, Murray, remembering his mother's words, sincerely thanks them for the first time, bringing joy to Hyun and Jisan. However, their joyful moment is abruptly interrupted by an unexpected anonymous attack. Miss Jisan falls to the ground, bleeding, while Murray's hand is severed. Shocked by Jisan's condition, Murray is momentarily frozen. The Zongan named Terrett appears and demands Murray. People try to defend against him, but Terrett effortlessly defeats them all with a single move. Terrett warns Murray, but Murray manages to escape with Jisan's body. Captain Lee, witnessing the attack, confronts Terrett, recognizing him from the information provided by Rishiru. Captain and her team stand against Terrett, but his power proves overwhelming. One by one, Terrett injures them, and Captain instructs Garam to evacuate everyone. Garam takes the injured team members and leaves. Captain relies on Murray's support, but instead, Murray takes Jisan's body to Juho, urging him to treat her urgently. Juho is surprised to see Murray expressing concern for someone. Garam returns with the rest of the injured team, and Juho, seeing multiple emergency patients at once, is initially confused. However, Rishiru arrives and uses Murray's blood as a hint for Juho to treat the patients, relieving him. Meanwhile, Captain continues to battle Terrett, but he inflicts severe injuries on her and leaves her on the ground. A green jelly-like AI named Neria appears and introduces herself as a regenerative AI left over from Nate Fesh's system. She offers to kill Terrett, giving Captain some relief. However, Neria suddenly disappears, and Terrett reappears, stabbing his sword into Captain's chest before walking away. Despite her injuries, Captain tries to get up, but Terrett throws sharp blades at her, tearing her body into pieces. Bleeding on the ground, Captain's thoughts turn to her teammates, particularly Commander Nuri, to whom she is deeply attached. Sensing something amiss, Commander Nuri urges Jian to drive faster as they rush to help their teammates. Meanwhile, Murray locates Terrett and prepares to fight him. They engage in a fierce battle, and for the first time, Murray decides to fight with his life on the line. Utilizing all his powers and tactics, Murray attempts to defeat Terrett, but Terrett proves to be extraordinarily strong, effortlessly countering Murray's every move. When Terrett starts targeting Murray's weakness and mentions Jisan, Murray can no longer bear it and rises to his feet once again. Terrett unleashes his ultimate power, creating a massive sphere and hurling it toward Murray. Despite his best efforts, Murray is unable to stop it. In that moment, Murray experiences a surge of human emotion and envisions his mother in a dream, urging him to stay with those who truly value him. Murray suddenly awakens in Juho's hospital, and Heian is by his side, overjoyed to see him awake after 3 days. Upon hearing that he has been unconscious for 3 days, Murray rushes to see Miss Jisan, who is also recovering along with everyone else. Jian informs everyone that Murray survived because he ingested the sphere created by Terrett. They are all together, except for Captain Lee, whom they believe to be dead. Jin argues with Commander Nuri, urging her to stop burdening people who are still recovering from the battle. However, Nuri scolds him and Juho, ordering them to leave. Her frustration is actually directed towards Captain Lee. Nuri arrives to assist Commander Nuri and reveals that the captain is alive. She offers a deal to Nuri, revealing Captain's location in exchange for Murray. Murray appears and asks Nuri how to defeat Terrett. Commander Nuri informs the team members that Murray will be leaving soon. Murray, along with Heian and Neria, prepares to depart for Area 3 Alau. Commander Nuri explains that this decision was made by her and Captain Lee, shocking everyone with the news of Captain's survival. Despite her frustration, Nuri agrees to take care of the team members until Captain's return. Neria assures them that she is treating Captain and that she will return soon. Captain orders Commander Nuri to take care of the team members in her absence. Neria will assist Murray in hunting down the Zongan chiefs and help him develop in advance. Neria, Murray, and Heian land on Jeju Island, where Alau is located. When someone asks Murray why they are there, Murray tells him that he is here to face his death.